ending up in the end of the 1989s, and coming into a new, more or less savage regimes taken or imposed from outside. So this is one aspect which may be common for the whole region. Another one is that, at least in Romania, the response of the authorities to the crisis was an illegitimate governing, which basically consisted of bypassing the parliament, so avoiding the parliament, and trespassing the constitution by enforcing a certain legislation for counteracting the austerity by means of so-called governmental ordinances or emergency governmental ordinances. This is obviously a first sign of lack of democracy, because in a democratic state where you do have a parliament, normally you should not avoid the discussion of whatever bills or laws in the parliament. A second observation is that, like others noted well in the previous panel, there is a clear and open dismantling of the social welfare state and of probably the most important of the pillars of it, namely the public services. Another characteristic is that, for those who didn't know, all these elements of the Europact Plus and of the other measures of the European packages in terms of austerity were implemented in Romania 2 years before they were implemented in other countries such as Greece, Portugal, and so on and so forth. And for this, with all due respect, we felt a bit, overlooked. In the worst sense of the word, because everybody's talking about what is happening in Greece. But let's be serious. What is happening now in Greece happened in Romania 2 years ago. The cuts happened in Romania 2 years ago. 25% of the salaries, 15% of pensions, which was later on reversed, 10% of allocations for underaged children, 10% of scholarships, and so on and so forth. And add to this an increase of the VAT from 19% to 24%, and you get a picture. And if you add up the average salary, which is around 150, 200 euros per month, then you can understand how brutal these austerity measures were in Romania 2 years ago, not now. 2 years ago, and they are still in force. All right, another characteristic is that there is a sheer attack against the trade unions and other actors of civil society in the sense of dismantling trade unions by implementing a certain anti-union legislation. Of course, the pretext or the official explanation of the government is that this is what is required by the Europact Plus and other European directives. But nevertheless, once you dismantle probably the most organized actor which can stand up, which can put up a fight against the system, basically you can rule, you can dominate the society. Another effect is that the Romanian society is more or less fragmented. That is to say, they resorted to divide et imperam. So different social classes, different groups are almost set against each other. The workers in the private sector are set against workers in the public sector. Teachers against doctors, workers against intellectuals, and so on and so forth. And this is a classical method of ruling by division, by dividing the society. Then there is another serious threat to democracy, namely undermining the principle of separation of power in the state. This is basically illustrated by the fact that the political power interferes with the judicial power and gives political command for the the issuing of certain legislation, which is, of course, the austerity legislation. Finally, but not last, I think another common trait which is specific to this region, but not only, is the intensity of corruption. Corruption at all levels, but especially at the highest level in the state, where due to it, certain privileged private companies are protected by the political power. And you have to imagine that in these years of crisis, whilst the population was suffering and it was impoverished by all these measures, others went from good to very good. Probably an issue which could be raised in this panel is for you as Croatians who are on the way of accessing the European Union, is to ask, did the fact that you were a member of the European Union protect you in any way from the effects of the crisis? And this is a question, this is an open question. I just want to close and answer very briefly, and then coming back, if possible, the answer is no. The membership did not protect us at all. On the contrary, the membership was used as a pretext to implement these anti-social and anti-democratic measures. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Now, I would like to continue with our panelists from the EU. In many analyses of the so-called transition period, Slovenia was usually depicted as a kind of a success story. And we just heard that the EU membership doesn't protect you from the effects of the crisis. So could you briefly comment on what went on in Slovenia during the last period? What were the impacts, what were the main effects of the austerity politics in Slovenia?
Okay, thank you very much for inviting me. It's great to be here on behalf of Workers' Punks University from Slovenia. Yes, exactly. The EU membership does not protect one in any way from the austerity measures. Quite the contrary, the austerity measures are the ruling mantra of the EU right now, as we can see on the news every day. So basically, the development in Slovenia in the last 20 years is usually characterized as being much more gradual in comparison to some other Eastern European countries. For example, there was not a very sudden privatization. It was very gradual. And at the beginning, after the disintegration of Yugoslavia, certificates were implemented in Slovenia. So each citizen got like a part of formerly state-owned companies. And it goes without saying that already some people at the very beginning saw this business opportunity and accumulated these certificates and became the new rich. But anyway, state still maintained some important ownership in most of the companies, especially the most important companies. And the shock doctrine was not implemented like in Russia, because Jeffrey Sachs was actually in Slovenia and he tried to argue that this is the best way, but unfortunately the politicians at the time did not listen to him. The situation right now in Slovenia is getting more severe. It's nothing like Romania. I think the struggle, the class struggle, if you want it, is much more undecided, because it seems to me both parties, the party of capital, that would be the state and most of the political parties, and on the other hand, I would emphasize for the side of labor, especially trade unions. We're quite lucky in Slovenia that the trade unions are still quite strong, and especially in the first mandate of the current prime minister, that was between 2004 and 2008, he wanted to implement a flat tax, which would be socially devastating, of course. And he was very uncompromising then, and he, at the end, I believe it was around 50 or 60,000 workers marched through the city center in Slovenia, and you must know that Ljubljana's got like 300,000 people, so it was really an amazing event, and that was in the middle of winter in the snow blizzard. So it became really obvious that the trade union side will not go for any compromises on that ground. Right now, the situation is different, it seems to me, in both ways, because on the one hand, the current prime minister has got the support of the whole European Union. As I said in the beginning, the austerity measures are the ruling mantra. They are something self-evident that nobody is actually questioning radically. Just modestly, like to what extent we should implement the austerity measures. These are the differences between the ruling and the oppositional parties as well. What is very warning is that right now they are trying to implement the golden fiscal rule and write it in the constitution. And it's very alarming that at the beginning it was a unanimous consensus among all the political parties, that goes for coalitional and oppositional political parties, that this is something that would be really good. On the other hand, of course, we still have the trade unions that still maintain very strong, but it seems to me that even they themselves have submitted to this logic of austerity measures and are just trying to negotiate a bit more modest austerity measures. And right now, I think they've negotiated actually with the government that overall 8% decrease in the wages of the public sector will be implemented. That will be different for depending on one's wage. For example, some wages are not coordinated to the standards, so some cuts will be bigger and some smaller. Anyway, what is really of significance in the sense of political ideology is also this, as Peter already mentioned, this divida and impera concept that is in Slovenia very strongly used when there's a discourse about the difference between a private and public sector. Because it somehow became another mantra that public sector is a kind of parasite that just nourishes on the value that a private sector as such produces. So in a sense, you have this perverted, diabolical, inverted image of public sector workers as being a kind of capitalists that are just parasiting on the surplus value, while the public workers and the directors are producing everything and so on. So the idea is that public sector should now take some responsibility as well, because private sector has apparently already suffered enough. There were many people that were fired. Not so much, however, in the public sector. So the hegemonic discourse is that, yeah, they should also take some responsibility. They should also sacrifice themselves a bit, because, you know, this idea we are all in the same boat and each needs to take his own responsibility. Lately, in the last couple of months, there were some more grassroots initiatives, especially at this 15th of October. We also had the occupation of our stock market, although it's very small. I think only 15 people are employed in Slovenian stock market. But these activists held this occupation for a couple of months. We also had occupation of a couple of classrooms at the Faculty of Arts for like 3 months. I mean, if we would be really nasty and very, very strict, these were all failures. But they were successes in some other and also very important sense, in a more discursive sense, because, I don't know, just some sentences that were really unimaginable a couple of months ago penetrated into the media discourse, like financial capitalism, just capitalism as such as a word. So I think if we would analyze them, this is something that these movements achieved. But right now, the question is how to continue this struggle, and perhaps I'll finish at this point.
Thank you, Andrej. By some accounts, Albania went only through a milder recession. So I'm wondering, Arlind, what actually went on in the post-socialist period in Albania, and to what extent was Albania integrated in the international markets so that it could actually experience this type of politics that the rest of the post-socialist region experienced?
Okay. First of all, I want to start by saying to all of you, dear comrades, and stressing the comradeship. Because as the Latin verb, word, etymologically tells us, comrades means those who share the bread before and after the battle. So if we are now here sharing our political bread, we should, of course, and naturally start to struggle together and then hopefully share our victory bread. First of all, I don't believe the statistics of the Albanian government. They can tell you anything. So in my perspective, I would have liked, really liked, to start with some kind of sentence like, a specter is haunting Albania, the specter of communism, etc., etc. But instead of it, and regretfully, I'm going to start with another kind of sentence, that vampires are hunting the Albanians. And these vampires are for 20 years in Albania. And the vampires, of course, are the capitalist web and local mafia, international mafia, and corrupted politicians, etc., etc. What we have experienced in these 20 years was some kind of, you know, Gaidar Yeltsin shock therapy, which meant that everything, or almost everything, entered in this process of privatization, which led to the deindustrialization of the country, mass unemployment, and of course the ideological hegemony of these neoliberals who defended everything as a sign of, you know, progress towards Europe, etc., etc. So what we have today in Albania is not the austerity measures taken by the government in the last 2 or 3 years, but a 20 years process of austerity, if I can call it this way, which means that almost everything is being privatized, except, of course, until now, education and health service. And even the army, even the barracks of the army are being privatized, some of them, of course, because we used to sell weapons, you know, to these, you know, Afghanistan and et cetera, et cetera. And as long as we consider ourselves to be in the NATO and we don't need any army, so we could privatize the military barracks and sell them for very, very cheap amounts of money. So, besides that, we were one of the first countries in Europe to impose the flat tax, 10% flat tax, which means that everybody pays 10%. From the house cleaner to the big companies, everybody pays a 10% flat tax. And if I may say something more, this crazy guy in America, Forbes, took seriously our Prime Minister, Sali Berisha, and told the world that Sali Berisha's economic model is a model for the world. So, and of course, it was used ideologically in Albania to boast the government, you know, this famous guy, Forbes, tells the world that the Albanian model is, is a, of course, a big success. And besides that, we have a 20% value-added tax, which means that everything which is purchased is going to cost 20% more. And of course, food, medicament, etc., etc. If I have to choose two symptomatic aspects of the Albanian social and economic process, I would pick the mine of Bulciza, which was one time in the socialist time considered, you know, this honor or the avant-garde of the Albanian industry. It used to have 10,000 workers. And now through the process of not really formal privatization, but through this renting of the right to use the mine to private companies, it has gone from 10,000 workers to 600 or so workers. And this is not the only problem with the mine industry. It is not only this traditional expropriation of the surplus value. It's more tragic than that, because private companies come there and not only destroy the environment, but are destroying literally the mine, because they want quick profits and they are not ready to invest in these, you know, how can I put it? To invest in the means of production. You know, they are just destroying everything and are just taking the minerals in the surface, gaining quick profits, and then leaving with the Albanian government's, you know, thankfulness for, you know, bringing foreign investors in, et cetera, et cetera. So what we have now is some kind of economic deserts where whole cities, maybe except Tirana and some other places, are being devastated, are being, you know, underpopulated, because the one-time means of production are just being destroyed. The economic environment is being destroyed. And we're not just talking, I have to repeat this, in this, you know, Marxist traditional expropriation of surplus value. Of course it is it, but it is much more than it. And the other symptomatic aspect is what the Albanian government in these recent years is trying to impose a Pinochet's voucher system for financing universities in Albania. The Albanian government is boasting itself for copying these reforms, you know, Milton Friedman, Pinochet, and these democratic guys, and implementing this reform in the higher university, which means that public money are being put away from public university to finance private and for-profit private universities. They are legally for-profit private universities, which means that not only the emancipatory potential of the university is being threatened, but even the right to go to the university is being exchanged for this commodification of the university. You know, if you have money, you can go to the university. Nobody cares if, of course, you are devoted to studying, et cetera, et cetera. Of course, the most tragic aspect of all this is the relative total apathy of the society. Society is politically so devastated and ideologically threatened that you have very little grassroots, you know, resistance. But I may see some rays of hope. Why? Last year, the miners of Bulcisa entered in a hunger strike down, you know, 1,000 meters inside the earth. And we as an organization solidarized with them, articulated, you know, even theoretically, their position. And the miners got some success. And the situation is still open. You know, there is some kind of formal agreement between the miner representatives, the government, and this foreign company, but the situation is still open. And on the student front, we are trying to organize the students. And we managed to have this small protest. Of course, in absolute terms, there is no much to hope for, because they are just showing 100 or 200 students protesting against this minor, educational reforms. But if we compare it with the nothingness before, okay, I might see some hope in there. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm very pleased to welcome Georgi Medarov from the New Left Perspective from Sofia on our panel. I guess you could tell us something more about the situation in Bulgaria, maybe a little update on the process of the privatization of the educational system and so on. Please do.
Hello, everyone. The general situation, I think it seems to me, it's like almost exactly what our friend from Albania was saying, like exactly the same, really. Because the flat tax was introduced, I don't know when was it introduced in Albania. In Bulgaria, it was actually like 5 years ago or something, like in 2006, I think. 2005. Oh, okay. We have also had this recently, this law was passed that public money for public schooling is now for higher universities, actually is transferred to private higher universities in order to implement like the competition between public and private in order to kind of emancipate the individual student so he could choose between private and public and like the state not to impose. All this kind of neoliberal agenda is being imposed there as well. And in the, but also in higher schools, it's quite interesting that this was actually implemented maybe 4 or 5 years ago, that even they tried to introduce competition between public schools so they could compete for public money between themselves. So this logic of neoliberalism is imposed not only by the means of privatization, but also by introducing these measures of new public management within, like, say, public schools, and they would make like teachers compete with each other within the same school, and schools competing with each other as well. And this was implemented by the so-called like social democratic government 5 years ago. And also for the austerity measures now that are like sweeping all over Europe, it was also, it's not also a new thing for Bulgaria. It was actually in a way from the end of the 90s, after the first waves of mass privatization, they started to implement like quite heavy austerity measures. And a currency board was introduced in 97, which the first, the left, the Bulgarian currency was pegged to the Deutschmark, and now it is to the euro. And practically, Bulgaria is a part of the eurozone because it is dependent on the eurozone policies, even though we don't, because there is no like monetary autonomy because of this. And so this is the general situation. And usually, also people like wonder why there is such an apathy in Bulgaria and so on. But the thing is, like in the 90s, there were like huge social movements, but they were quite misguided, and we had like general strikes for mass privatization in the 90s, like the trade unions were organizing this kind of stuff, and all this was legitimized through the discourse of the against corruption, you know, like because there was this idea that there is this corruption that is a remnant from the socialist time, so we have to fight it through the destruction basically of the public sector and like the state bureaucracy, which was supposed to be kind of inherently corrupt. And these were the like the liberalizing policies were seen as an instrument to fight against corruption. So that's why it seems to me we have to be careful with this talk about corruption and to think that we live in some kind of a unique situation in each of our countries and to think it's just because our political elites are corrupt, whatever this means. And this is not capitalism itself, but it is like the corrupt form of post-communist capitalism. And that is also a problem of like the concept of post-socialism even, because it seems that there is something like completely different, which like when I hear like it's the same, but it's the same what's going on in Greece now. So why would we think that there is something like corrupt about it if this is like the normal logic of the system in a way? And that's basically it, I think.
Thank you. I guess that at this is the point that I was going to make. I think that now that we heard the analysis of each individual countries, maybe it's time to move on to the questions of resistance and organization. And I invite not only the panelists but also all of you here to really join in to this debate, and so that we can, in a way, crystallize some type of strategies or some kind of common denominators on which we could build our political movement. I guess that the whole idea of the Balkan Social Forum lies in the fact that there are similarities to these countries, and that based upon these similarities and these more or less same problems, we can devise one, I'm almost tempted to say, one size fits all political program that could be implemented in each country. So let me now pose a question to Mate. Of course, I'm very privileged to speak to you in English.
Likewise.
What is, in your opinion, what are the most efficient modes of organization on the grassroots, and how will the left be able to connect the grassroots struggles and the grassroots movement and organizations to the institutional levels. To what extent can the left really capture the institutional level and in that way control the most important policies, economic and so on?
Well, I'm lucky or unlucky to speak last, so I do not have to repeat what everybody else has said, because a lot of the things that the comrades from other countries have said are similar to the Croatian situation. So just to give a short overview, the last 20 years of transition or capitalist restoration of capitalism in Croatia have been, well, we can say basically a failure, especially concerning the deindustrialization of the country. Right now, the shipyards are being destroyed under the dictation of the EU, which is the last remnants of Croatian industry. The same goes for agriculture, etc. Basically, the whole privatization scheme was really disastrous for Croatia. And right now, since we have not been able to stop our entrance to the EU, basically this will be cemented, and Croatia will, well, if there is not some kind of radical change, will be will just remain a peripheral, marginal part of the EU, and basically undeveloped. So, as I said, a lot of the things are the same as the comrades said in other countries. And as for Croatia, there has been really a surge in, well, let's say, progressive leftist activities in last 5 years. So a lot of changes have occurred, and this is really apparent in public discourse, for instance. So let's say in 4 or 5 years ago, it is almost impossible to even mention capitalism in public, or even the word neoliberalism was just used in academic circles. But now it's, for instance, last fall, they were debating in Croatian mainstream media, they were debating the possibility of world revolution. So really seriously, so things have been changing. I think the most important activities in last 4 or 5 years were the anti-NATO movement in 2008, then the student movement, which has also started in the same year, and which had in 2009 two large waves of university occupations, and was very publicized and very, well, it was not successful because it did not achieve what it sought, free education, but it was very successful in other ways. And also this year we had rather good anti-EU campaign from the leftist perspective, which was also unsuccessful, but still some results are here in this in the concerning propaganda, concerning leftist propaganda against the EU, and putting some arguments there from a progressive point of view. And also what is interesting, that in last 1 or 2 years, for instance, Croatian workers who have also been striking a lot and protesting, there have been some voices about workers' self-management again, which is really interesting. And those are not some ideas that were implanted to them from, for instance, from these radical leftist circles, but these are really their own ideas. So not all of Yugoslav ideas are forgotten. So about the perspectives and what Mislav has asked, well, I think that Croatia is, and I think this is also, it has a little bit of our position, for instance, concerning the media and public sphere is a bit different if you compare it to Western states, the United States, UK, Spain, and similar countries. And I think that also the participants of this forum could see that for themselves. For instance, last year when Professor Harvey was here, he was, for instance, on one show on Croatian national television. He talked there for an hour about anything, and I don't know, the subversive film festivals is in the mainstream news, and for instance, Srećko gets to talk on national television every week and stuff like that. And I think that all of you who come from Western countries know that, for instance, Marxists cannot appear on national television in, well, there is no, there all the television stations are private in the United States, but it is not really possible for Marxists to speak, for instance, in mainstream media usually in the United States or in Western countries. In Croatia, it is possible. You just don't say that you're a Marxist or a leftist or a radical leftist, then it's everything is fine. You can talk about world revolution and stuff like that. So this is a really, well, basically, it's not because Croatian media are really democratic, etc. It is just because that all this craft of liberal censorship, they have not really grasped it to the end, and they do not know how to, because prior to the 1990s, we had a very much open censorship, so you could not speak against the regime publicly. But now you can, and they're not really, you know, they're still not really good at keeping people who they should keep away from the media away. So this is a really big opportunity. So the left can also take advantage of that if it is capable to do that. And as for the institutions, of course, I think that we should take the institutions, and I think that in countries like Croatia, again, differently from Western countries like UK and stuff like that, where I don't think there is much possibility in the near future of in the United States, UK, or countries like that, I don't think there is much of a possibility of a parliamentary success of the radical left. I think in Croatia and in countries maybe like Bosnia and similar countries, there is hope that something like that, if the left will be clever enough, can be achieved. And I think the problem here is that you cannot say really it's socialist, leftist, or something like that. But if you just leave out these kinds of nasty words, then anything is okay, and people can, even people who think of them as right wing, they will just accept these ideas as pure ideas. So I think this is a big possibility. Whether Croatian left will be clever enough to use that, I don't know, because we have the same kinds of problems as elsewhere. There was an interview with Boris Kagarlitsky at Real News Network, and when they asked him what is the biggest problem of the Russian left, he said, well, it's not just sectarianism and ideological reasons, it's basically human relations. So, well, this is kind of a problem we have here, so we shall see what will happen.
Thank you, Mate. So I guess two issues I think remain. One is this mismatch between grassroots organization and institutional influence. And for this region in particular, to what extent can these different countries cooperate, since one part of the region is already in the European Union and in the Eurozone, and the other is in the process of the accession or even outside of the Eurozone. So I think I feel that this is the point of entry into this debate, and I'm going to pass the mic to Peter.
Yes, I just want to make a number of remarks. The first remark is that I had a feeling of déjà vu hearing our colleague from Albania and Bulgaria. So without restating what they said, it's almost can be taken out. The same in Romania in terms of the education, so-called reform, and the hailing of the Bologna style and lines of direction, and the mining and destruction of industry, and so on and so forth. Now, and the same in terms of having the concept of neoliberalism as a taboo, so it's not being used, it's hardly being used, and it's avoided especially in the mainstream media, and it's being used only in the academic circles. And I think this is something which also has to be broken through. Now, in terms of resistance, because Samir mentioned, raised this issue, I would like to put forward two aspects. I think, at least in Romania, there are two ways, if I may call them so, resistance. It's a formal one and an informal one. In terms of formal, the vector, the main vector were, I have to use this term, trade unions. And indeed, again, the same deja vu feeling. In the 90s, they did take the streets and had mass protests, but in fact, they were misdirections because, in fact, they were used as elements of destruction of the former system. Then, as time went by, until the 2010s or 2011, when we had the last major demonstration in Bucharest against the austerity measures, they got weaker and weaker, and the explanation is multiple. I don't want to insist on that, but basically it does have a connection with the leadership, which does not anymore present enough trust for the members and for the people, and some of them are corrupt and have been put behind the bars for whatever corruption reasons, and of course then their call is not followed anymore. So this is one issue. In terms of informal resistance, I can mention a very important series of events which happened in Romania in the end of December, early January this year, end of December 2011, January 2012, when in different cities, beginning with Bucharest and other places in many cities, people simply took the streets against the attempt of the government, of the neoliberal government, to change the healthcare system law. It was something which was never met in Romania for 20 years. It was not organized. Trade unions feared, literally feared, to join and to state their support of the people taking the squares and the streets. And we as local trade unions tried to push the national leaders to take a stand, but they didn't want to take a stand. However, the idea is that the government wanted to change the healthcare system in the sense of privatizing the emergency sector, which is very important for in case of accidents, for helping the elderly and whatever. And the head of this system is, in fact, an Arab doctor. He is, I think, a Palestinian. His name is Arafat. He's a famous doctor in Romania. He studied medicine before 1989. He remained here. And he stood up against the government, and he was so clean in the sense of not being corrupt. Or nobody could say anything about him, and people rallied, found him as a vector of resistance, and they stood up against Arafat, who was actually dismissed by the president, and the president had to come back and ask him to take back his job and withdrew the legislation. And that was the beginning of the end for that government. They replaced the government with another government. It was a cosmetic thing, and the head of the new government was the former head of the Foreign Secret Services. They stood in power 78 days, and now, 2 weeks ago, they fell due to a motion. So it was due to these popular movements which were not organized. And I think it's important to mention that this did happen in Romania. So, yes, I stop.
Okay, thank you. You are all now welcome to ask questions and also to make comments on these issues. So, you know, the idea is that we have an open debate, not just this front type of discussion. Yeah, James. Yeah.
Okay. Samo trenutak, molim vas.
Uh, So I just wanted to, sorry, my name's James. I'm actually from Australia, but I'm living in Belgrade at the moment and studying the region. So that's my, those are my credentials in some extent. So I wanted to just sort of draw off this point that Mislav sort of said, and I wonder if you meant sort of, it was just a little bit of an offhand kind of point that, you know, how do we find this sort of one size fits all question to the Balkans? And this poses a question to me because I'm not sure to what extent we can talk about the actual, certainly in terms of the economic policies that are being brought through. I think we've found a very kind of common ground here, but I wonder as those manifest themselves in the political realm, if that's actually, if there aren't sort of differences that we can talk about meaningfully. In particular, I want to think about the national question and the way in which this relates, because if you think about the situation in three Balkan countries, I'm thinking Serbia, Kosovo, Macedonia, you're seeing the ways in which the way in which austerity is manifesting itself is in a very different way and is actually sort of coming out largely through a question of ethnic conflict, a question through national conflict. So if you think about privatization in Serbia has not just been about integration into the EU, it's also been about, you know, they sold off the gas works in order to get diplomatic support from Russia on the question of Kosovo. And so austerity in that sense is actually implicitly tied to how Serbia is trying to impose its rule in Kosovo as well. In the case of Kosovo, once again, one of the ways in which we can start to explain why there hasn't been more resistance to what is an incredibly disastrous policy of austerity. And, you know, as I think Argon has written, you know, this is a sort of neo-liberal, neo-imperial experiment that's being undertaken in Kosovo. Part of the reason why this isn't being challenged is that people are so scared that there will be a reimposition of Serbian rule that they're willing to do almost anything so long as, you know, America, the EU, sort of the powerful Western countries actually back them there. And again, there's a very good article in an edition of the Serbian magazine Solidarity that just came out, which deals with the question of Macedonia and tries to talk about the way in which austerity measures are actually facilitating this sort of conflict of a very clientelistic approach of how we get resources from the state in a situation where those resources are absolutely declining and how this fuels into an ethnic question. So my question for the other participants would be, two. On the one hand, to what extent is this simply, you know, let's say a Balkan version of what we're seeing also in Hungary or in France, sort of anti-immigration, anti-Roma sort of racism? Is this simply just our version of this sort of racism? This our version of, let's not talk about the economy, let's talk about immigration, let's talk about Islam, let's talk about Roma. To what extent is it that? To what extent is it different? The next question would be to the comrades that are not from the three countries I mentioned. Is the national question actually refracting itself in the same way in Croatia? So, for example, in Serbia, you cannot talk about the EU without talking about Kosovo. I mean, rejection of EU is because they won't recognize Kosovo. I mean, so actually fighting EU integration requires fighting Serbian nationalism. And I wonder, is that the same in Croatia? Is that the same in Bulgaria? Is that the same in Albania? That would be my question.
Thank you for your questions, James. Obviously, the situation is much more complicated or complex when you take into account all of these features that you mentioned. So the austerity program, I guess, is more or less the same. You have basically the same set of measures, right? But, you know, the way that it is implemented, that differs from country to country. And, well, why should I speak when we have all these wonderful panelists?
Not only panelists.
Okay, Catherine.
Well, first of all, comrades, to use the term, I would like to congratulate very strongly for the organization of this. This is very, very important. I am here with a different hats, I mean. I'm here for the European Commission of the French Attack. I'm from France, Catherine Samary, and I am also involved in the radical left and international involvement against that system, of course. I want first to make a remark on the fact that the core peripheral relationship in Europe and in the world are the result, of course, as you know, not of only European Union and the Euro, but of capitalism as such. And it was implemented, of course, in the 19th century and 20th century, and the revolution which occurred in Yugoslavia and elsewhere were resistance to this. And what is ongoing is an attempt to destroy in consciousness and in social resistance, in political resistance, all the revolutions and assets which in the 20th century tried to resist, well, badly, with failures, to resist to this relationship of domination. And one suggestion I make, which is not only, which is not passéiste, turned towards the past, which is not to put a rosy picture on the past, which is not only also intellectual, but political and democratic. It's to win for all the people involved in the Balkan, to will the self capacity to express what was their own history, because the Western dominant capitalism want to bury this. So that's the first remark we want. We have to contribute to this. Second, I want to stress the fact that some people, some country will decide to be in the euro or outside the European Union. But the policies, policies which are implemented are the same, in different conditions, but are the same. And I do believe that at the level of the international social forums and regroupments and actions, we must not put frontier where they don't exist. So we must both, and I would, I'm very in favor of a Balkan social forum and regroupment, European social forum and regroupment, not to oppose one to the other, but to articulate, like to articulate a national resistance to the global one, in order to give a no to the European Union institutions and treaties, but on the leftist internationalist point of view, and with a relationship of force which has to be built, like Tariq Ali said in the forum yesterday, also the day before, it must be regrouped. It must be at the global level, and there must be regroupment. The last point I want to stress, and I finish in there, I have put forward in the ATTAC network the proposal with the Hungarian comrades to establish a specific workshop on core peripheral kind of relationship within Europe. And of course, like it had been said, the existing vampire capitalism has implemented what is called, which we should not accept this formula, austerity policy. It's a vampire policy, like has been said, has been implemented in Eastern Europe before Greece. And Eastern Europe has been, it's terrible, the vanguard for the implementation of flat tax. What I wanted to stress first, that, like has been said, Slovenia resisted to this, not protected by European Union, but protected by relationship of force in Slovenia, which means that you can resist to existing dominant policy on the basis of relationship of forces. We must not give illusion. Of course, in Slovenia, the European Commission, like the International Monetary Fund and like the World Bank, had made all pressure at all times to oppose what was your resistance and the trade union resistance. And in name of being a member of the European Union, you had to accept the flat tax and so on. But we must and we can resist, because it's not only a problem of Eastern Europe, of Greece, it's also a problem in France, it's a problem elsewhere, it's a problem also in Germany, it's a problem elsewhere. Secondly, there was the European Union is a specific construction. I don't want to develop this. I have written some article. I want a collaboration and analysis on that. I don't say I have the final word on that. But there is a specific construction, which, like Tariq Ali said also, was political at the beginning, and is still pretending to be a political construction, not like NAFTA free zone. But of course it is dominated, like also Samir Amina said, it is dominated by market rules, by the core countries, among which German and French core countries played a dominant role, of course. But the bourgeoisie of those countries played a dominant role. And we can change this. And they had a different policy toward the South country in 86. And in the end of the 70s, they increased the budget to permit the South country, which were not described as pigs at that time, but as cohesion countries. They increased the budgets for those countries in the period which was still a kind of Cold War. And for Eastern European countries, they wanted to destroy systematic the past. They wanted to destroy by systematic privatization the system. So there is specificity of that policy in Eastern Europe and also common issues. So we had both to delegitimize what was the specificity of a global and vampire privatization with external but also internal actors also, and also put the emphasis on what is common.
What is common, which is the fact that Eastern Europe is supposed to be the model of a generalized vampire capitalism, and we have to fight together against that.
Thank you, Catherine. Another comment, I guess?
Hi, just wanted to pick up a little bit
what was said previously is also by Peter and our comrades from Albania and Bulgaria. And I would like to draw a little bit of the attention of a certain danger that lies ahead of this work of remobilizing regionally. Namely, in the past, as the crisis hit also the centers of capital, Europe, including European left, has discovered only lately that Eastern Europe has been the vanguard of neoliberalism. Well, we knew that all the way along, and also including radical Western leftists have only now recently discovered in the past 2 years or less that critical and resistance work has been done in Eastern Europe. And it's important to avoid in making these new alliances it's important to avoid making the step back towards framing the alliance within the logic of resistances against the logic of transition. Because the movements, and including practices of resistance, but also theoretical and public sphere movements, in Eastern Europe, in Romania especially, but also in Hungary, have moved beyond that. Yes, we know that Eastern Europe has been the vanguard of neoliberalism. Yes, we know that this the flat tax and all the whole from the 90s on, the shock therapy, privatizations, attack on trade unions, all this is only now being brought to the center of European Union. But it's important to, and this is the where this moment of reunion has the chance of becoming an opportunity, is important to go already beyond that, beyond framing our re-mobilization and reunion in terms of a resistance against austerity or against the logic of transition. Now, the resistance movements themselves already are gone beyond that. We already have a story of how bad the transition was. We already have from Eastern Europe, from different locations, a narrative about that which Western leftists, with almost no exception, have no idea about. So it's important in this process of rediscovering each other to go beyond the logic of transition and see already from the start how the Balkan Social Forum and resistances against capitalism and against neocolonialism and imperialism are in Eastern Europe framed in a positive way. Yeah.
I'm going to have to agree with my colleague over here on the left. I'm from Bosnia and Herzegovina. I just want to say that I fully agree with him that the austerity measures might be the most wonderful thing that has happened to the left for the past, I don't know, 100 years, because giving us an opportunity to come together and go much, much further than just fight against the neoliberalism, but kind of go beyond that. And I fully support that.
Okay, nice homage to austerity measures. Yeah, in order to go a step further, I think that we need to try to locate specific problems and specific obstacles in this regional reunitement, if you will. I think it is, at this point, I think it is quite clear that we all understand what austerity measures are, how they work. We've seen that they are quite similar in each of these countries. And now it is, I guess, time that we find this common denominator and start to think about the origin, forms of resistance or forms of political movement that can really push us away from the austerity politics into what we could call radical social policies. But we need to think of them in concrete terms. So if we could kind of focus on the particular issues or obstacles that are set between these countries, and I do like the point that James made. Austerity can even be misinterpreted in terms of that, you know, in each country austerity was imposed under a specific set of political prerogatives. And in each country, you know, austerity policies work differently. So we need to think about, you know, the context that is really that has been built up in each country, and so to make a proper comparison, and so that we can kind of make this platform real, based on some real political analysis. Yeah.
Yes, one of perhaps the major weakness of the radical left or potential radical left, not only in Eastern Europe, in the Balkans, but everywhere in the world, to various degrees, but everywhere, is that it seems that until now it has not been really able to offer an alternative or alternatives. That is, maybe this is felt even stronger in Eastern Europe in general and in the Balkans, in the sense that the people perhaps are now convinced that the system in which they are living is bad. But what is the alternative? And therefore they accept it because they don't see any reasonable alternative. And I think that on that ground, the radical left or the potential radical left should be moved to the offensive on two levels. One, the strategic longer view, and second, the immediate strategic targets. On the longer view, strategic view, I think we have to re-legitimize the question of property. That is, nothing really different can be done and better unless we question the private property, particularly the really existing private property, which is the private property of monopoly capital, not of poor people, of a small bourgeois and so on. I think that has to be said and said and said and repeated. I don't know to which extent it is it is done in your country. I am ignorant, but I see in other countries that I know a little better that it is done, whenever it is done, in a very, very timid way. Timid, 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 terribly timid. That is one. Second, on less than longer view, immediate strategic targets. I would say that there are some principles. One of the principles for managing, let's say, the economy at national level, even in a relatively poor country or country which is dependent in many ways, to diversify the partners. And that goes more specifically for the countries which, having integrated the European Union, and for some of them, directly or indirectly, the Eurozone, that they have accepted this, I think, dangerous illusion that almost the exclusive partners should be the stronger Western European countries. Diversify the partners. That is, start relations with Russia. And I think on that ground, the Serbians were not wrong, whatever is the political frame for it, with the BRICS, with China, with others. It is not to do it in a naive way, of course, but to diversify. That gives you a margin. Now the question is, the issue, to which extent this is possible within the rules of the games, if we call it so, which are put by the European construction. That is a series of very concrete problems, I think, but I'm not sure that I'm right, of course. I think that there is a margin, even in that frame, but it is possibly a very limited margin, small margin, but even that is not, I don't see it, but I know. For instance, for the Balkan, I ignore it, if it is put on the agenda or not.
Thank you. Yeah.
Okay.
It's okay. I wanted to comment about Macedonia. Relating to the question of the comrade, and I think that it is important to mention that what he has mentioned about nationalism, because one big question is why the situation is deteriorating in all the Balkans, and it is in front of the people and people don't care about it. One of the way of doing that is through stimulating nationalism. Nationalism as a method, as a tool of destruction of the attention from the of the people of the real problem, and this is doing this is making the government very effectively in the Republic of Macedonia. Ethnic Macedonians are caring what the Albanians are doing to them. The Albanians are taking care of what Macedonians are doing to them, and the capitalists are stealing meanwhile. And some important data, like they have reduced for only 1 year the unemployment benefits for 38% in only 1 year, it is totally outside the public discourse in the Republic of Macedonia. Why is outside? Because people are built with nationalism. So I think that very important, especially in the ethnically heterogeneous countries like Macedonia, the leftists must understand that anti-nationalism is very important struggle. And I think that in this area, we the left in Macedonia had made quite a big progress. A lot of leftists in Macedonia understand that they must fight nationalism, and this is very different from some old leftists from the former regime who will call them national conscious leftists with sarcasm, that is. So one of the way to cooperate between Balkan countries is on anti-nationalist level, because it is very strong when some comrade come to some country and attack the nationalism in their country. And when you do that in reverse, it is very effective. Also, the issue of flat tax in Macedonia, they have introduced in Kosovo, in Albania, in Bulgaria, and they are using in every country the same sentence that if they reintroduce progressive tax, it will be bad for foreign investment. If we agree on common action against flat tax, I think that it is quite a good idea, concrete one.
Thank you. We'll get back on this question of nationalism. Daniela, you can go on.
Okay, thank you. My name is Daniela Dolenec. I think my comment has this kind of what I spoke about yesterday with Igor, a performative function. And what I wanted to stress is most of the conversation so far has been focused on identifying the common enemy. And what I want to bring in to this performative level is affirming the principles and the values that lie behind this. So, you know, instead of just saying, we're not saying we don't like austerity measures and that we don't like a neoliberalism or economic reductionism or whatever you want to call it. What we're saying is we see that it produces a deterioration in social, political, economic rights of citizens. We see a growing inequality. I don't have data for all the countries in the region, but I have very, you know, recent data for Croatia, which shows that nearly 20% of the population is at risk of poverty, that we have increasing inequalities measured by any measure you want to choose. And what we're saying here is that this is a problem because this erodes the very essence of democracy and democratization, which Samir Amin has been mentioning so many times today. So the question that comes from this comment is, to what extent have left progressive movements and organizations in other countries apart from Croatia succeeded in rehabilitating, so to speak, the questions of social justice, which have been severely delegitimized in the post-communist context? Thanks.
It's Samir. Okay. No.
Merely as a tactic in resistance, and it should be taken only like that. In tactical wars, it's very often very useful to change the terrain of the war, change the battleground. Yes, the Balkan question cannot be dealing from the general European Union question. That's the local battleground. But I want to give you a crazy idea of how another battle has been shifted. And this is the battle of the solidarity of Palestine. Now, the question of Palestine is a battleground is what we call Middle East, or we prefer to call West Asia, Middle East being a colonial term. And that's been the battleground. But due to the international solidarity movement, global justice movement, a lot fostered by the World Social Forum, there's going to be a very peculiar event later this year, which is a World Social Forum in solidarity with Palestine in Brazil, and not in West Asia, not in Middle East, not in around Egypt, Iran, but in Brazil, where the forces of radical left are going to meet for a world forum for solidarity with Palestine. So you have changed the battleground in such a way that you're expanding the solidarity to a question which is otherwise localized in geographically. Now, what comes to my mind is a crazy idea. While the battle between the austerity measures of Europe and its impact on Balkan must go on with all that has been said, there is in the recent years another kind of emerging hegemon which is taking on the traditional hegemon being the capital of US and Europe. And this emerging hegemon is a very interesting phenomena which we call the BRICS. Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa. And I can tell you a lot of the European crisis is today studied in relation to the emergence of BRICS. The emergence of the economies of China, India, Brazil, South Africa, and how they're impacting negatively on the economy of Europe. Now, it has both good and bad aspects. I won't go to get into the analysis. But what it tries to tell me is this could be an opportune moment for the radical left of Balkans to create solidarity linkages with the radical left of the Brooks and shift the terrain to exactly that kind of competition between the hegemons that is happening between Brooks and Europe and US, so that this solidarity can create links where both the alternative aspects, which is one of the greatest challenges, what is the alternative, can be seen in different lights and not in the light of only confined to European Union and Balkans with respect to European Union, because the economy has changed greatly in that sense. And I, to my mind, a kind of a forum process provides that opportunity for expanding the radical left forces with the BRICS radical left forces to create a new force of resistance which looks at alternatives which are different from where we're grounded, and we tend to look from that all the time. And I think these kind of solidarity movements are the kind of forces of resistance that I would greatly think have potential of extending our solidarity.
Thank you. Any further comments? Yes.
Well, sorry, my name is Sasha. I just I wanted to say that I've heard here few things that strike me as a suggestions already. I mean, there was an idea that that in Croatia, if you don't speak as with the label of leftist or whatever, that you can have a success. There was suggestions that some demonstrations that were related to medical, to health system had success. Education has a success. So it's all issues that are very human, that are very general issues. And without the label, they present, I think, a public interest at that very moment. So just a matter for me is the question is how to make that basic line and say, okay, we can put the front line somewhere, which is general front line, let's say education and health and maybe something else. And then instead of, not instead, but also going down into the communities and widening that space. I mean, how it is possible to bring something on level of education that will be transnational in this Balkan sense, how it is possible to make some kind of a health things that are transnational, so that will be practical, not just as an opposition, but as a contribution to the community. So for me, it's just not just a theoretical question, it's just a practical matter, is how to contribute, and that will raise and that will raise the issues as well, and then use it as a platform to unite and to develop further. So what would be the practical ways to do it down, whether be it with industry, health, or education?
Thank you. Okay. I'm sorry. We have one speaker before Catherine. Okay.
No, please. I already intervened.
Okay. Hello to everybody. I'm Vuk from Unitary Organization for Socialism and Democracy from Bosnia. I would readily come back to the issue of the nationalism. In all the other countries with almost solved national question in different ways, the austerities are easily the first subject to debate. But in the country such as Bosnia, in such a complicated mess, it is severely complicated to go out with such issues. It is not just a question of a different nationalistic manipulations, as comrade from Macedonia said. In Bosnia, we don't have two problems, but three of them. And in fact, the fourth that is imposing self as a common patriotism, or at least some kind of petty bourgeois urban pro-European ideology that is also nationalistic. And in such a political illiterate society, those are still the first subjects. And if you start to talk about austerities and what will happen, they will accuse you for a conspiracy theory. in fact. They just don't want to listen that. They you know, the society is still is some kind of lethargy. But even though now the newspapers and headlines are speaking about new credit that we have to take from the IMF to continue with financing the immense bureaucratic apparatus that exists in Bosnia, now well, something is starting to happen. But what is then happening? Then the nationalistic elites and ideologies are starting to strengthen nationalism, because they know if they don't get a credit from IMF, they will not be more able to pay to their clients in the different institutions. They will not be able anymore to buy a social peace, and that the social unrest will be a consequence that they that without a question. So what exactly to do? I would like to hear the thinking from the other countries. Okay, I'm sure we have the biggest problem in the region, probably with Macedonia and Kosovo, perhaps. But what is happening in Bulgaria? What is happening in Albania? How? What are the experiences in those countries of fighting with dominant nationalistic discourse that is of course allying to the national glory, to do some kind of historical, even to, I don't know, even combining itself with some kind of epic fantasies, and then imposing through the universities, university professors, and the other institutions. I would like to hear experience, or at least thinking how to create adequate propaganda that can fight against it. Thank you.
Okay, just a couple of short comments. Yeah, Samir first.
Yes, I think the question of nationalism is very, very important. Now, nationalism is a very ambiguous word and concept. It can be the worst and it can be the best. And we ought to be very careful. Now, nationalism, whenever it is understood by the local ruling class, call it local bourgeoisie, I would call it a local comprador bourgeoisie, is hate, usually, of the neighbor, which is just belonging to a society submitted to the same over global system of exploitation. This is not nationalism. This is comprador nationalism, because they call to the rescue against the neighbor that they hate a bigger power far. And they accept being submitted to that bigger power. Therefore, they are not nationalists. This is comprador nationalism. And we ought to distinguish that clearly from nationalism, if we call it so, also the same word, of what I would call the defense of the nation as the frame of popular forces. That is the sovereignty and the right of a people, call it as you want, whether a nation homogeneous or not homogeneous, within the frame of a state, vis-a-vis the major powers operating, and not the neighbor, vis-a-vis them. That is nationalism, which is positive. It is national popular. It is national anti-comprador, not comprador nationalism. We ought to be very, very, very careful about that, because what is being made is using the ugliness of comprador nationalism to condemn the attempt to be autonomous vis-a-vis the major dominant powers, in the name that this is nationalism also. It has not at all the same content, and I think we should be very, very careful about this generalized condemnation of nationalism. It's ugly, it's chauvinism, and so on. It is not only that.
Thank you.
Well, I would just like to say that I'm Vladimir, I'm from Belgrade, Serbia. I would like to say that our struggle is, of course, on an economical level, but it is also on an ideological level, because the idea of the left has been completely delegitimized in this region, because politicians and media are trying to convince us that socialism led to the crisis, that the country fall apart because of the socialism, and they are trying to convince us that the Europe, the neoliberal Europe, is the only way. They say in Europe everything is privatized, the education is being paid, the health system is also, you have to pay if you want to go to the doctor, and it's completely normal, and if you don't want it, then you want to go back to the bad communism and so on. The other option in Serbia is trying to look towards Russia. Of course, it is not alternative in an economical level. It's a nationalistic thing. But since the crisis, since the rising of the left in the Europe, I think that that on the level of idea, the things are changing. And in that sense, our struggle has to be international. That's why we are looking towards Greece, toward France, towards Spain, what is happening there, because the struggle in these countries can also help us to raise the question of the left in this region.
So just very shortly on the issue of nationalism, that a concrete way of fighting against comprador nationalism is to find the bigger frames in which one can discuss nationalism, because as we know, you know, through the 90s and 2000s, nationalism in relation to Eastern Europe has been constructed ideologically as the biggest unit of thinking, yeah, from Tony Judt and Rogers Brubaker to towards the right. And so those bigger frames to which we within which we can relate nationalism to fight against comprador nationalism and recover positive autonomous nationalism are by thinking nationalism in relation to uneven development, so as a way of within the global capital accumulation networks, and secondly, and connected to this, to think nationalism within the bigger framework of racism, because the ethnocentric forms of nationalism that emerged in the 90s throughout Eastern Europe are forms of racism, and because now the moment of in which in within Eastern European countries you have a middle class that has already emerged is also the moment in which a nationalism of the middle classes has come to forth, which is actually a thoroughly racist identity, Eurocentrist identity. So that's the story.
Vuk, and then you. Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, yes, I agree with you. In fact, with Samir, because I think we are the first organization that put in Bosnian media the term comprador, comprador bourgeoisie and comprador nationalists. But when we are speaking about positive nationalism, I wouldn't call it at least nationalism, because it is internationalism. It is fight to protect the working places, the working people, and working people internationally. It is not a form of chauvinism, and it is not a form of calling for the hatred for the neighbors or for the different ethnicities in Bosnia. But in Bosnia, we have also a form of Bosnian nationalism that calls all people in Bosnia to unite, but it's also a comprador patriotism. It is the EU comprador patriotism. So it is also in Bosnia, there is no form of positive nationalism that you were talking about. It doesn't exist.
Okay. You wanted to make.
Yes, I have an answer to one of the questions. I'm sorry, but I forgot who asked about the improvement in healthcare throughout the region. I believe it was the lady with blonde hair. I don't know if it was you or somebody else. It doesn't matter. Okay. Thank you for pointing that out, where it was, because there is a lot of room in healthcare to actually react. Healthcare, as we all know, is being used as a money machine. And I have to emphasize one point, which I bet not many of you know. Bosnia is not a part of the organ donor network. It's not, just so you know. There has been an initiative that it becomes one, but it didn't come true. And I have a very dear friend who needs a kidney. And through that friend, I found out the following information, which is that the organs, even though they are donated freely without charge, are actually being charged for by the organ bank. So let's say they get a kidney and they sell it for 30,000 euros. Or I don't know exactly what the price is, I'm just guessing right now. But they're selling it. And even though, for example, you find a bone marrow donor and they're doing the transplant and he's willing to give it away for free, they still charge 150,000. I mean, it's just ludicrous. And it's not mentioned anywhere. And there's a lot of room over there where we can all come together and do something that will that the people will recognize as something that needs to be supported.
Okay, I'm sorry that we have to finish this discussion. We have a few more people that want to say something, but unfortunately there is no time, and we have to conclude. So I will give Stipe the difficult task of summarizing all of this in a closing statement.
Thank you. Difficult, maybe impossible. I will see about which of the two.
Just the second that we have a bit of a technical issue here. Okay, you can start.
Okay. So my task is a bit experimental. I don't know. Has it been explained already what the purpose is? So basically the idea is that. Throughout these debates, and hopefully at the end of them, of this part of the program, that is the Balkan Social Forum, or towards the Balkan Social Forum, the idea is to have some form of concluding statement that would then try to to identify what is a possible common. A common ground and platform for future cooperation. That is for more steady and maybe more systematic cooperation of all the people gathered here. I think many of us for the first time in anything remotely like this type of setting. So including people from various different countries. So the idea is basically to propose, to summarize some of the issues that have been raised, which could provide a basis for the formulation of some kind of common platform. And as Mislav stated at the beginning, he proposed basically austerity as the framing. The entry point for this. We have heard that some people think that we should go beyond this, and that to some extent, but I will try to defend this emphasis on austerity, because of course I agree with everybody who says to focus on that exclusively or on neoliberal restructuring and so forth, that is not enough, and certainly from a left perspective, that is from the perspective of forces that really have not given up on the ambition to transform societies in a more fundamental sense, that should not be the defining horizon of debates. But at the same time, I believe it is not only a discussion amongst leftists. It is also the left, if it does not find a way to communicate and to become an active force in society, then it hardly can be called much of a left. So I believe that austerity, as someone has said, it's a gift. Well, I wouldn't be too enthusiastic about this type of gift. But at the same time, one thing is definitely certain. The left, in comparison to other periods of capitalism, for, especially the so-called welfare state Keynesian period, which we now know has been relatively short-lived and was a historical exception, but which still somehow functions ideologically, especially in Eastern Europe, as the normality of capitalism, which we are, which is only a question of time that we will all again reach. But the neoliberal period, and especially now the austerity politics, have at least done one thing: that their arguments about the social destructiveness of capitalism as a form of social organization have become now very immediately not only visible but felt by many people in Europe and Eastern Europe, and also in core countries, but also in countries from the Balkans. So I believe that that we have to take that we basically there has been this question about about articulation between different levels, and I believe that more or less there is no alternative to taking what is immediately given as a social reality and is experienced as such as an immediate problem of the lives of most of the people. That this, of course, is then a necessary reference point. But it should not be only that. It should not be the limit. It should be an entry point which has to be framed. Okay, maybe a too long an introduction. So I'll try now just to summarize some of the themes that have been put forward. Not all of them are located on the same level of abstraction or generality, but so I'll just go through them, and then we can see how much of that can be used or cannot be. So one thing that has been mentioned is the problem of the bypassing of democratic procedures in this push for austerity. And of course, any kind of platform, of a left platform, would have basically to take that as a problem, or to put emphasis on this, that the alleged democratic nature of the societies we live in, well, has been questioned by the very forces that claim to be the guarantors of a democratic order. Then the second thing was, of course, the dismantling of the welfare state, the attack on public services, the criminalization or marginalization, that is ideological criminalization and marginalization of the trade unions, which are still, of course, institutionally and historically the one major force of the organized working classes, however weak they may be, or however corrupt and inefficient they often are. So that would be another point, I assume. The question of, to at the same time try to address the existing trade unions and also fight this ideological criminalization of their role. This, of course, is connected with the question of the logic of rule by division, and which often takes the form of a campaign to antagonize public and private workers against each other to push them into some form of competition. So the question is then how one could or how one could bridge this rift without falling into the holes that have been dug ideologically. Then we have had the question of corruption, which is a bit more ambiguous, for because in the East, of course, in the Eastern Europe, it has often been used as a source of legitimacy, okay, the word won't end, won't flow, so we'll have to find another. So corruption has been used as an ideological narrative to legitimize privatizations and the assault on the public sector. But maybe one, if we reframe it a bit, if we say that if we formulate it as someone has proposed, as an illegitimate influence of private actors on politics, then we can say, well, corruption in that sense has at least two forms. One is openly criminal, the other one is already normalized in the form of public-private partnerships. So that would be maybe a proposal to turn it into an offensive device from the left. Then, well, of course, then privatization and commodification we've already mentioned, and the problem of the ideological representation of the public sector as parasitical, unproductive, and the source of corruption. So all of this basically is just a follow-up on this. And then many people have mentioned the question of the problem of a flat tax, but more generally the question of regressive taxation reforms. So that could also be, I assume, be a rallying point for all of us. Then, of course, most maybe very central deindustrialization and unemployment. But that is, all, of course, a very tricky question. But that maybe is something that would allow us to reconsider certain arrangements that are taken as given. That is, as Samir Amin and some others have emphasized, the fatal exclusive fixation on partnership with Western countries, which has then translated into a complete acceptance of the rules of the game, and which for many countries in Eastern Europe have then translated into, well, deindustrialization and unemployment and a form of integration which makes us more and more a periphery without productive resources, and which is losing also much of the knowledge and creative capacities of the working of the workers, which are, well, thrown out of any chance of meaningful participation in social life, because unemployment often means just that. And, well, more questions, but probably more tricky ones. The question of how to coordinate grassroots movements with institutions, and relating to that, possible strategies to try to capture institutions, which, well, that is a major question, I assume. And, well, I don't know to what extent nationalism, or the question of nationalism, or forms of nationalism, or racism can become a question around which some sort of a final statement could be made as some sort of common ground. But that is, I assume, but this was only the first debate now, and so this is not this is not intended as a final word or even an exhaustive mapping of what, everything that has been said now, but just maybe to some indicators of where debates today and tomorrow may lead us or may not. And maybe some of these things, I mean, I assume much of it will be discussed throughout these days, and hopefully and hopefully it will help us to find a satisfying formulation for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Stipe. The next panel starts in half an hour. Be here.